The first question you should ask is, why are you recommending one surgery over another for my dog? Now, the reason this is important is because not every surgical procedure for CCL surgery is appropriate for every breed and size and weight of dog. I'll give you an example of my dog. So he was about 75 to 80 pounds at the time of his first TPLO. I did two consultations, one with a family vet who had years of experience doing lateral suture technique. And then I did another consultation with a board certified orthopedic surgeon who primarily does TPLO. I asked each doctor, why do you recommend this procedure for my dog? And then why do you not recommend the other one that was suggested? So it is important to know the doctor's rationale of why they think that one procedure is better than the other. How many of these procedures have you performed? And the reason this is important is because even though these are very complicated procedures surgically, there are weekend seminars that doctors can go to learn how to do TPLO, CBLO, TTA, and MMP. And so if this is the case with your surgeon, then you'll want to know if your dog is one of the first ones who will be getting the procedure done by them. Obviously, you want a doctor who has done these many, 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 many times. After surgery, will my dog be kept overnight? And if so, is there 24/7 veterinary staff on premises? Now, the reason this is important is because at some veterinary hospitals, they do keep dogs overnight, but there's no staff to monitor. And I know it sounds crazy, but it happens. And so if that's the case, the next question would be, well, if there will be no staff present overnight, then can I take my dog home? My dog has severe separation anxiety and they've never been without me overnight. How will I know my dog will be okay? Now, this is more of a question of, you want to see if the surgeon is going to describe some of the medications that he or she will use to keep your dog calm and sedated so that they're not, you know, freaking out in the crate or, you know, in the recovery area. You just want to know that your dog will be kept calm without you. Can you prescribe trazodone in case my dog becomes anxious and difficult to settle down after they're back home from surgery? Now, this one is super important because a lot of times dogs come home and this dog might be the chillest, the coolest dog, never gets rattled before surgery. And then they come home, they're in pain, they don't understand what's going on, and they're howling and crying and screaming all night. And then what happens? You have no recourse. You could go to an emergency vet, but that's a pain in the neck. Your dog just came home. It's going to be so hard to move them. You want to be able to calm your dog down rather quickly if this happens. And so you want to have the medication right there. Doesn't mean you need a whole big script for this thing, like a 30 or 40 tablets. You might just want to get a week's worth so that you can see if you need it. And then if you do need it, you get the rest of the prescription filled. Or if this surgical center is far from home, you might opt to get a full prescription with enough tablets to last you so that you don't have to run out midway through recovery. Which pain medication will be prescribed? Now this, we see so many different meds prescribed. One, carprofen, tramadol, gabapentin, there are Medicam, there are lots. And some people say tramadol is not the best one. That was the one my dog was prescribed. So do a little bit of research, but definitely ask the doctor which medication they recommend for pain control and why they prefer it over the others. Will my dog be sent home wearing a fentanyl patch? So my dog had a TPLO done first on the left leg, and then his right leg was the second leg. First surgery, we got sent home with regular pain meds and an anti-inflammatory and antibiotic. And on the second TPLO, he was wearing a fentanyl patch. Fentanyl is very strong. It's for pain control. You will not give fentanyl and another pain med on top of each other. It's not needed and could be dangerous for the dog. So make sure if the doctor says yes to the fentanyl patch, you need to understand all the things that go along with that. side effects, the fact that you cannot let your dog get overheated. That means putting a heating pad on your dog, letting them lay on a heated mat, letting any heat source come near that fentanyl patch because the medication pours out of the patch and into your dog and can overdose them. So a very serious drug, and you need to know all about the warnings that come with fentanyl. If my dog doesn't weight bear directly after surgery or like within days, when do I start getting worried about it? Now this answer comes with a lot of variability because every dog heals differently. You might have had a dog that started limping and then had surgery a week down the road and has hardly any arthritis. This dog might be a younger dog with more muscle mass versus a dog that is older, who maybe the pet parent did a little bit of conservative management. The dog had some arthritis in the knee. The dog has some muscle atrophy. So that dog is going to take longer to heal and maybe longer to bear weight. The question you want to know is, when should I become concerned? How long is too long for a dog to not weight bear post-op? How much swelling is normal after surgery? Okay, so with this one, you want to know kind of what it's going to look like. Maybe the doctor could go over some normal signs of how much swelling will be present post-op. I also recommend that you just do a Google search like TPLO swelling and then look for images of that. You want to ready yourself so that you know what normal looks like and then what abnormal looks like. Will you describe what razor or clipper burn looks like? And if my dog develops this, should I put anything on it? Now, clipper burn happens when the dog is shaved closely with clippers that might not be very sharp anymore. And so what you'll see is right after surgery, there will be a normal amount of bruising that happens. And then a little bit after that, you'll see some redness. It almost looks like when a kid falls down and scrapes their knee. It kind of looks like road rash, like that. So some people are rubbing like triple antibiotic cream on it. Some people are doing vitamin E cream. Coconut oil, essential oils, don't do it unless you talk to the doctor. Know what the doctor has to say because maybe he or she will just say, put on an ice pack, it will resolve in a couple of days, or we don't want you putting anything on this whatsoever. If the doctor does say you can put something on it, make sure you take notes as to what they prefer. When bruising appears, how long will it take for that to go away? And how much bruising is normal? One of the things that I see in my Facebook group is that people are so upset about the bruising. You guys, the doctor cut through bone. What's in the middle of that bone? There are blood cells. They're cutting through skin. They're disturbing all kinds of tissues, right? And so it bleeds. That blood that escaped during the cutting is underneath the skin. And as the body kind of works on this, the red blood cells that are outside the surgical area and around the surgical area, there are actually little cells that are coming in to clean all that up, and there will be white blood cells to prevent infection and stuff like that. So there's lots of healing in that bruising. Bruising is normal. Some dogs get a ton of it, and some dogs miraculously, I don't know how this is, they get hardly any. If you see bruising, it will go through stages. It will first be red, it will kind of turn like a really dark purplish red, then it goes to like a greenish, bluish weirdness, and then it goes to like a yellow weirdness. And so just know that it is normal. And it isn't just that you're going to see bruising around the incision, it can actually kind of travel down lower than the incision. It can go toward the inside of the dog's thigh. So talk to the doctor about what is normal with bruising. If my dog licks the incision, do I apply anything to it or clean it with anything? Now you guys, hopefully you're going to be really diligent and your dog will be wearing the e-collar. The e-collar will hopefully prevent the dog from licking the incision. Why is this important? Because there are bacteria in the dog's mouth. When they lick the incision, these dogs are more prone to infection later on. And you think, oh, well, they just get a new antibiotic. Well, yeah, maybe, and maybe it'll work. But what if the bacteria get really deep in there and they infect, and the infection goes as deep as the implant? Now you're talking about another surgery and another recovery. So if you want to get over this fast, my hearty advice is cone collar, whether it's comfy cone, the plastic cone. I don't love it. Dogs don't love it, but that's why there are other options. The comfy cone is a material cone-shaped collar, and then there are the inflatable ones. So definitely try to avoid your dog licking the incision. But if your dog does do this, you want to know what the doctor will have to say about that. Some docs don't like the incision getting wet, so they don't want soap and water. They don't want any rubbing of the incision, besides that really hurts. And don't go and put wacky things like essential oils. And I say wacky things, and I use essential oils every day. However, I don't put them on my dog. That's just my opinion. A triple antibiotic cream might be another thing that the doctor might suggest, or they might just say, leave it alone. The antibiotics will do their job.